I'm the author of Design Your Life Planner, 90 Day Planner, Goal Setting, and Day-to-Day Activity, and I appreciate that you're here today. I'm going to walk you through some goal setting tips and a workshop that will truly, I think, renovate your life and get you off to an accelerated start. If you are just joining and you want to share this with your friends, it's going to rock. I'm going to have to move faster than I planned because I've been talking for a half hour. I've been talking for a half hour to myself and it didn't record. I don't know where it went, but it did not record. So if you want to share it, go ahead and share it, and I'm just going to jump in. I know so many of you on the call today, you come from all walks of life, that you're in businesses, and many of you are like me with Mary Kay. So for some of you, this is your goal setting workshop, this is your unit meeting night, and I thank you for the privilege of getting to share this time with you today. I really do believe that it's going to be time worth your while, and I'm going to give it my best to give you my best over these next over this next hour. So again, if you're just joining, feel free to share it with your buddies and let's jump in. You know, December 26th, I love the week in between this and New Year's Eve. And so when Linda Tupin posted that today, I was reminded of my winning group of friends and how we've really just taken advantage of understanding critical windows of time. And I want you to know this is a critical window of time. This window between now and the first of the year is a critical window, and you are on the front end. You are on the accelerated end of working to make amazing things happen. Congratulations. You know, you could be sitting on the couch, you could be having another plate of cookies, but no, you were actually waiting for me for 30 minutes. Oh my word. I do hope it makes you feel better. Okay, so what we're going to focus in on today, we're not going to do the entire 90-day planner, but for those of you who have a planner, when you did your homework, I'm telling you what, I know you're excited because you knew where to start putting some things. Your goal setting started to come together. For those of you who don't have a planner, if you ordered it after midnight on the 21st, we'll be shipping again on the 28th. The 22nd was the last day we shipped out. If you're wondering what I'm talking about, go to PamelaShaw.pink. And it will be there for you. Okay, so let me jump in this small printed font because all my fabulous cards are down there on the floor. Oh, Hanahina. Okay, today I'm going to focus specifically on what I consider to be three life changers, the deal makers, the career turning points, the celebration pillars. You know, forget the date book that you're using. It's like I said the last time, date books are what you, what show you what time and where you need to be. That's what a date book will show you. The 90-day planner and this process that I'm getting ready to share with you, it is going to guide you into life-changing awareness. It is going to support you in creating awareness and habits and intention and thought-shifting mindset and allow you to commit to making the hours of your day desire the desire of your heart. That's what we want to do differently. So when opportunity presents itself, you know what? It's too late to get prepared. If you're a high school or college athlete, it's too late to get prepared. ACT score, it's too late to get prepared. A job application, a promotion, it's too late to get prepared. I'm going to challenge you today. If you're not prepared when an opportunity arises, it will be too late. And so today, we are getting prepared. We are getting prepared. There are countless success stories, those of you who are using the 90-day planners or who have gone the 90-day process, and I'm hearing more and more stories. And here's what I want more than anything. I want these next 90 days to be your success story. Are you with me? Do you want these next 90 days to be your turning point, your catalyst? I believe that no matter where you are, the next 90 days can rock your world and be an incredible turning point for success that you're going to have. In fact, I believe that whether it's health or a size or a financial increase or a promotion or a swelling hobby that you have, that whatever it is, that this process is going to support you. The process itself is 20 years in creation. I have been working the process for 20 years. It's 16 and a half years in copyrighted publication. And there are so many success stories. The truth is this, you can change anything in 90 days, anything, a relationship, your career, your body, you can change anything in 90 days. It's just that without the process and without the accountability and without the focus and the coaching, most people won't without the system. And so that's where I'm going to walk you through today, three critical pieces of it. So let's talk about goal setting. You know, I don't know about you, but what I've observed is that people who even teach goal setting aren't good goal setters. There have been times when I wasn't a good goal setter, but I could teach you a great goal setting class. And I didn't feel good about myself then, but I did it anyway. Because sometimes staying in motion, and let's just forgive ourselves, sometimes staying in motion is better than just throwing our hands in the air. There are people who spend more time planning their 1 to 2 week vacations than they actually invest in designing their lives. They spend more time on that vacation than they do their careers, their relationships, or their finances. And if you have become a lifetime goal setter, you will place yourself within the top 5% of all people in the world. And these goal setters, you become the most intentional human beings on the planet. As I look back on my goals for 2016, I accomplished some of them, but not all of them. Some continue to elude me. Habits, I set some. I nailed some. Some have eluded me. Some need remolding still. But without those goals in place, I would not have a measure for how the year went, and I would be tempted to be focusing only on what did not happen, what I didn't do, how I didn't perform, why I keep... Do you see me shrinking? When I only focus on what didn't happen and what I didn't do, then goal setting becomes that. And we find ourselves just looking back. We find ourselves just constantly looking back and telling ourselves all the negative stuff about ourselves. So wherever you're standing right now, I want you to face in a different direction. Okay? This represents, behind me represents your past. And there's a lot of success on that past. There's a lot of success between when you started and when you got here. There is success there. But where we're going, bar the doors, Becky, because we're going to turn and face in a new direction. So today, whether you're a new leader or an aspiring leader, or you're in another business or another job or another career, or you're opening a business or you're out of the country, whatever you are today, you are leading, and you're leading the most important group of people, and that's yourself. Leading yourself well is going to be the most important thing you can ever master. When you learn to lead yourself well, not perfectly, well. I'm a lifelong project. You're a lifelong project. When you learn to lead yourself well, others will be drawn to you because they will notice. You won't have to tell them what you accomplished. They will notice who you are, and they will want to be a part of that success. So let's go back and let's review the questions, because a lot of you did your homework and I want to hear you on your homework. Okay, so here's the homework. The homework was to ask yourself a series of questions, starting with the biggest one, which is, what do I really want? What do I really want? As I face in this new direction, starting from this point moving forward, what do I really want? And then those 7 questions. I've been so energized hearing your answers to these questions, I can't even begin to tell you. So what would make 2017 your best year ever? List 10 things you would wish for in 2017. The third one was, what's one previous goal that keeps eluding you? The fourth one is, what's one change you'd like to make inside of yourself? The fifth one is, what's one habit you'd like to master? The sixth one was, what talent or gift would you like to own? The seventh one was, looking back on 2016, what's one piece of advice you'd give yourself? These answers, as you wrote them down, as you journaled, tell me if I'm right, they started to move you in a direction. They started to tell you where you want to go. They started to unfold right in front of you what your goals are. Yes, did that happen? The more you wrote, did you start saying, yes, now I know what my goals are? Oh my gosh, I'm so excited for this. And I'm going to ask you to write down some more questions. So those of you who are typing in, will you go ahead and type these additional questions in? Because these next ones are going to be important for you to consider as we move forward. Think about this. What were your biggest time wasters in 2016? What robbed you of your time? What took away your time? What distracted you in 2016? Next question. What, if any, limiting thoughts or beliefs cause you to doubt your ability and your direction? Next question. What's the loudest fear you have about yourself or your success goal? What's that loud fear that you keep hearing? Here's a very important question. What voices have I allowed into my life that aren't serving me well? Whose voices did I let speak into my life? Ladies, let me tell you something. The five women in your world, the five men and women who speak into your head, the five people who get to you every day, whether it's social media or live face in interaction, those voices will create the sound in your mind. And those five people will determine the way that you think, who's speaking into your mind. And lastly, what will I do to fade the distractions? What will I do to fade the distractions, eliminate doubt and fear, or move away from those voices and those friends? What will I do to move away? When was the last time you set a specific goal? You know, I imagine if you get on here on December 26th, you're a goal setter. And there was a time when you set a goal and there was a time when you were awesome about setting goals. But when was the last time that you set a really specific goal and accomplished it? It had a start time frame, it had an ending time frame, it was a SMART goal, it had measurable components. When was the last time you set a goal? And how did you feel accomplishing it? So let me ask you a question. Why haven't you set another goal that you were that committed to accomplishing? You may think that you have. I will argue that you haven't. You have thrown something out there maybe. Maybe you've written it down. But if you've been stuck in the same place for a long time, you have not set goals. That aspect of goal setting was missing. So we're going to start with SMART goals, S-M-A-R-T. I'm going to say some things today that I said also 30 minutes ago because I've been talking for an hour now. I know you've only been hearing me for 30 minutes, but I've been talking in here for an hour. I was on top to myself in my own head. Have you ever done things that you think, look, I did that, but it really didn't ever manifest? See, sometimes you got to make sure that either it's the Wi-Fi that's working, that there is a connection in order for things to happen. And we're going to set goals today differently from ever before so that that connection is a part of what you're doing. I'm going to say some things today that you've heard before. I'm going to say some things today that will be fresh. My prayer before I got on here is that today, when you hear the familiar things, you won't go, oh yeah, I already know that. You know, because you can be a good teacher of goals and not actually set goals or accomplish goals. So today I want you to hear from a fresh template, fresh ears, fresh eyes, fresh heart. And then for the things that you hear that are new, I pray that God would pierce your heart and say, yes, this is the one to jump on. So the goals have to be, first and foremost, something that you want. What do you really want? What would make 2017 your best year ever? You guys, dream big. Stop playing small. Stop piddling around. If 13, 14, 15, and 16 look a whole lot alike, stop it. I tell you, stop it. We are going to step it up. We are going to amp it up. I mean, can you think of a big amount of money that you want to earn? Can you think of a big out of the box thing that you want to accomplish? I'm going to challenge you to really think it through because all goals have to be SMART. S, they are specific. What is the specific goal? I want to get more fit. No. I want to get smaller. No. I want to make more money. No. I want to travel out of the country. Nope. Specific. They have to be immeasurable. Like from start point to finish point, how will I know that I'm there? How will I measure it? A great goal has a measurement. A, it's actionable and it's achievable. So what action will I do to hit the goal? R, it has to be realistic and rewarding. When I make this happen, my heart will sing. What is that? What's the rewarding piece of what you want to do? And realistic, like I can't go from here to, I can't read all the Bible before tomorrow. I can't go from here to size zero by tomorrow or the end of the week or the end of the month. So there's got to be a realistic time frame within what you're willing to do for it. And then tangible and timely. That's the last one, timely. Socrates said, the secret of change is to focus all your energy, not on fighting the old, but on building the new. Are you ready for that? Not on fighting the old, not on fighting the old, but building the new. If you haven't yet physically, I want you to physically turn your body in a different direction. And I want you to face a focal point in your office, in your home, in your car, wherever you are. I want you to face in a different direction. And I want this symbolism to go with you wherever you go throughout your day, throughout your month, throughout your year. Are you ready for 2017? Are you ready for something new? Because this, from this point forward, this is the direction that we are going together. Okay, let's take a look at the goal board. Now, because I am now filming it And I can see myself. I thought I was filming it before, but I couldn't see your heart, so I didn't know I wasn't on. I was just talking. These are all going to be backwards, and I know that, but this is my only option right now. So we're going to keep going right where we are. These are in your design book, and I had these posters made just for you, but that's okay. The goal areas: spiritual, family, career, physical, personal, social, educational, financial. The biggest mistake that most people make is that they pick goals in too many categories. That is the biggest question. That is the biggest problem. If you're a goal setter, you're a seasoned goal setter, you can pick three. If you're new to goal setting, you can pick one category, maybe two at the most, okay? So which categories, as you did all of your homework, which categories kept emerging for you? What kept coming out for you as to where you were going to set goals? Was it spiritual, family, career, physical, personal, social, educational, financial? Do not set goals in all the areas. Yes, you can certainly work to get better in every one, but I'm asking you to throw your heart over the line in one or two areas so that you can get this win. This is going to be an important piece of it. And so when you... I'm going to give you two questions to start asking yourself every day, and I want you to write these down. I want to see them on the chat multiple times, and I want to know that you have memorized the goals. The first question has to do with this, okay? The first question is this: what will make today a winning day? How will I know I'm winning? What will make today a winning day? How will I know that I'm winning? And the second question is really, really simple. It's an oldie but goodie, and it's as simple as this. Is what I'm about to do taking me closer to my goal? Is what I'm about to do right now, in this minute, is it taking me closer to my goal? Two questions. Got it? How will I know today's a winning day? How will I know that I'm winning? And secondly, is what I'm about to do eat out of the refrigerator? Is what I'm about to do turn on the TV? Is what I'm about to do scroll through Instagram? Is what I'm about to do read other people's tweets? Is what I'm about to do taking me closer to my goal? You've got to have the discipline to say, no, it is not, and stop. How will I know that I'm winning? Define it. And is what I'm about to do taking me closer to my goal? Those two are truly, truly key. Once you've got your goals decided, then you'll look at the long-term piece of it. And the long-term portion of the goal is simply to invite you to say, you know, a year from now, where will I be in this goal category? Let the goal have a long-termness to it. Now, for those of us in our Mary Kay world, seminar is a logical long-term benchmark. So even though we're midway through our year, I still think that's a good long-term goal because you've got a lot of things that you can accomplish between now and then. So regardless of the industry that you're in, if it's 6 months or a year, let that long-term goal. Notice that there are only 1, 2, 3 of them right here, and then you put in the category that it is. So let's say it's career. Under the career, it still has two goals there. What are the two goals in that long-termness? What would you put in that long-term in the year piece? And then you're going to have to shorten the goal. Once you take the long-term piece out, you're going to go to the quarter. 90 days is the next one. 90 days is the life of the design book. So you take the goal and you divide it into 12 months. What would need to happen in 90 days for me to know that I am close to my goal, that I am on course for this goal? You guys, if you don't take the time to break this out and to get honest with yourself and to know your starting point, ready? Nothing is going to change. Do you want 2017 to be your most outrageous, your most fantastic, your most intentional, your most accelerated year ever? Then if that's the case, you have got to grab the process and you have got to write down the long-term goal. And then you have got to break it down into a 90-day goal. The life of the book, every day is going to count. It is going to come together. It is going to accumulate. You've got to trust that's the process. Your goal has got to have a keen, thoughtful, prayerful behind it, which is why I gave you the homework in the beginning. When you delight yourself in the Lord, He will give you the desires of your heart. Two of my Design Your Life scriptures that I stand on are just very simple. Psalm 32:8, the Lord says, I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. I will advise you and I will watch over you. I will advise you. Talk about a great coach. Talk about a great life coach. Can I get an amen? I will advise you and I will watch over you. God honors big dreamers because big dreamers honor a big God. It is up to you The second one I also love, I gave to you in the preliminary, Psalm 25:4. It showed up in my quiet time last year. Show me the path that I should walk, O Lord. Point me out in the right direction to follow. I place my hope in you. To have a good year, you got to have a good quarter or two. To have a good year, you got to have a couple good 90-day segments in there, sisters. I've heard my friend Glory Banks say for years, to have a good month, you got to have a good week. And you can break that all the way down. To have a good week, you got to have a great day. To have a good day, I want you to replace the word good day with winning day. To have a good quarter, you've got to have a winning week. You've got to have a winning day. And so I can't experience the joy and elation of winning if I don't practice winning. I can't practice winning if I don't define what winning is for me. Take it to the bank. Success accumulates. It accumulates. Take any category, it's going to accumulate. Okay? If I get online and I shop, and I overspend more than I earn, I will go into debt. If, on the other hand, I earn more and more and more and more and more and I live under my means and I invest wisely and well under the good counsel of an advisor, I can create wealth. If I eat chips and junk and fast food every day and I remain sedentary, I will gain weight, I will be unhealthy, I could be fat. If, on the other hand, I eat mindfully, I eat food that God created, I eat clean, I choose an active lifestyle, then I will be healthful and taking my responsibility and have a reasonably, my body will settle into its own best. It's a process of accumulation. That is not brain science. However, we treat a day like it doesn't matter. We treat an hour like it doesn't matter. We treat a month like it doesn't matter. And how many years have we treated like it really doesn't matter? We get the same result. We're like, oh, whatever. I'm just not doing something right. No, stop it. You know why? Because from this point, moving forward, you guys, I don't want you to beat up on yourself. We are way too good at that. But I also don't want you to let yourself just completely off the hook because you don't want to feel bad. We are going to stand in a place of responsibility. And from this point moving forward, we are going to set goals differently. So here's the thing. Writing the goals are one thing. Checking on the goals are another thing. You've got to take it to the next place. And the next place is by the end of the month. By the end of the month, how will I know that I'm on course by the end of the month? Define what winning is by the end of the month and then by the end of the week. How will I know I'm winning by the end of the week? It's easier to keep up than to catch up. Write that down. It is easier to keep up than to catch up. And now here we are on the front side of 2017. It's going to be easier to keep up than to catch up. Are you with me? Okay, if you feel like this is being beneficial and you feel like it's going to support some of your friends, please share this to your wall and let them know because we're going to dig in deeper right now, starting right now. This is the process, you guys. The goal setting, 90 days, 1 month, end of the week, end of the day. How do I know I'm winning? Because if I'm winning today and I win again tomorrow and I win again on Thursday and I win again on Saturday, I have a week of winning and that accumulates. It just has to. It just makes sense. So the process is writing the goals is one thing and checking on them is another thing, reviewing them, tweaking them is another thing, and remaining accountable is a fourth and important thing. So to all of you Lone Rangers out there, anybody consider yourself to be a Lone Ranger? I want you to take this to the bank. Connection is the elixir of sharpening your character. Connection is the elixir of sharpening your character. You know, when I get together with my friends who use an iPhone, we always share something that I didn't know that they know. I learned something from them that they know that I didn't know when we get together. I can't tell you how many people I've taught how to airdrop photographs. I'm like, feel so smart when I teach a 20-year-old how to airdrop photographs because a lot of people don't know how to do that. But because we get together, we connect over common ground, we both get better. That is the reality. So when we're around friends and like somebody said today, hey, I'm going to Nashville. I'm like, oh, go eat at this place and or try that. When you're connecting, then you get better when you're connecting with the right people. With my workout buddies, I used to work out upstairs in my workout room, which is pretty awesome, actually, and do Tony Horton, do P90X and P90X2, P90X3, and I worked out alone. But now that I work out with buddies in a gym, I would not miss being there because just like today, just see you. Okay, let's just talk about today. Today, because I put out there last week on the 26th, I'm going to be with you on the 26th, and I will be here at 3:30. My phone was blowing up. My text was blowing up. My wall was blowing up. Are you alive? Are you hurt? Kay Manship calls. Cody Maldonado calls. Cindy Max texting me. Angie O's texting me. Are you okay? Kay's getting ready to drive to Bowling Green. Why? Because I'm connected. I chose to make myself accountable. I told you where I would be on the 26th. When I woke up this morning, can I tell you where I did not want to be today on the 26th? I did not want to be here on the 26th. I liked my sleep pants. I liked my no makeup look. I liked the cookies that are downstairs in my kitchen. I liked not having a schedule, except I did go ahead and work out anyway. What I want to tell you is that because I was accountable with you and because you knew I was going to be here today, that saved me this morning. And you know, if I was in a real crisis, like maybe I could have been in a real crisis, somebody would have been over here to check on me because of the connection. So all you Lone Rangers, stop it. Connect. We were built for connection. There are reasons that we should connect. It is so important that you choose to do that. And so let's move to our second category of goal setting. And that is the process simply of just getting to the end. It's just getting to the end of a week. This is the process that nobody does. And this is what separates the deal. Okay. The purpose of having the book combined for your daily activities and your goal setting is this very next thing. When you get to the end of a week, you're going to ask at the end of the week, for those of you who can read backwards, what did I do well? You know, we focus on what we don't have. It doesn't matter how much we have, we focus on what we don't have. I confess, during the holiday season, it's tough for me. It's tough to focus on, not to focus on, that I lost my husband 10 years ago, that Thomas lost his dad. It's hard to not focus on, we're not together as a family that way at Christmas anymore. I lost my dad in March. It was hard not to focus on his not being here this year. People who focus on what they don't have will never get more. So the gratitude is, I have the privilege of going through this Christmas focusing on other people, celebrating other people's successes and joys and births and babies and families. I have the awesome privilege of celebrating where my son is at the season of his life, my mother, and so on and so on and so on. The focus is forward. The focus is gratitude. This is a critical piece. So at the end of the week, you've got to ask yourself, what did I do well? Forward focused. What did I do well? Sometimes, let me tell you, want to hear what I've written down here? Sometimes I had 80 ounces of water every day. Some weeks that was my win. You're like, really? Yeah. Some weeks that was my win. So what did I do well? What can I improve? What can I improve? Focus forward. From this point forward, what can I improve? And then lastly, review the long-term, short-term, and benchmark goals. Oh yeah, you go back to the front of the book, you go back to your journal, wherever you're keeping them, and you review those goals. Most people write goals on December 31st, they forget about them by February 1st, and then they feel terrible all year long, they don't accomplish anything, they stay in about the same place, they earn about the same amount of money, they stay in about the same position, they stay with about the same friends, nothing really changes because they don't go after the goals. In my Design Your Life process, every week at the end of the week on Saturday night or Sunday, when you redesign your next week, you're gonna look back at your goals and you're gonna reread them 52 times a year, lowball. Can you stand it? This is a game changer, rereading the goals. One of two things will have to happen. Either you will have to change your goal or you'll have to change your behavior. But you will not keep reading that goal week after week after week after week after week and not doing the activity required to get it. You will force yourself to either change the goal or change your behavior. So that's what's exciting to me about the 90-Day Planner. This is at the end of the week, and I will do some more about that because I want to jump on into, since I've already said all this part twice, I want to jump into the next thing. So let's move to the category of affirmations, and I think I can go back to my, I think I can go back to my cards now. Whoop! It's easier than that Liberty print. Okay. If you haven't yet, go ahead and share this to your wall because this is going to freak some of you out. This is going to get some of you are going to get really creeped out in this next place. But I'm going to talk about affirmations and it's going to be good. So we've got the goal setting piece. Can I move on from goal setting? Pick the category. Long-term goal. What would you be completely overwhelmed? What would make 2017 the best that you accomplished? That's the goal. That is the category. Whatever you answered there, what would make 2017 the best? When you said that, that's your number one goal. When you went through your 10 things that would, your wish list, those are the other subcategories of goals. You create the goal, you break it down into 90 days, you break it down into the end of the month, you break it down by the end of the week. Now, when you come back, you're going to have to create activity today to set your week up so that you can accomplish by the end of the week what you need to accomplish. And then you do it again next week, and then the next week, then the next week. Now you have your month. Then you do it one more month and two more months, and you've gone through one 90-day planner and a 90-day cycle. But the way you choose your first goal is the answer to the questions, what do I really want? What would make 2017 the best year ever? That's how you get through to setting the goals. So I'm gonna trust that we've got that process to start the template of goal setting, and we're gonna move on into the possibilities of affirming those goals and talking to your brain and telling your brain something. Now, for those of you who will start to think from this point forward that I have gone out there, this past year I have invested a lot. The past 2 years I've invested a lot of time in learning about the brain. I had a wonderful conversation yesterday with my nephew who's in medical school in New York about epigenetics. And Ben's always been the smart one. So can I tell you how excited I was to just have a conversation about epigenetics and how the brain can override DNA? I felt a little smart. And here's why I feel smart. Because your brain is so magnificent. Your brain is so amazing because you are fearfully and wonderfully made. The Creator made you in His own image. Your brain is a brilliant, capable, has wild possibilities that you have never, ever even stepped into. So there are 75 to 150 trillion cells in your beautiful body. Cells impact your thoughts. Your mind changes your DNA. Your mind changes your brain. Your thinking affects your today and your tomorrow. Your thinking affects your today and tomorrow. We're wired for love. We're made in His image. We learn to fear. Deuteronomy 30, 19 says, I lay before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live. 75 to 98% of mental, physical, and emotional illness comes from our thoughts. When God's word tells us in Romans 12, 2 to renew our minds, it is not a casual suggestion. We've got to recognize the responsibility to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Everything we do and we say and everything we take action on, it was first a thought. If our thoughts go wrong, everything goes wrong. And yes, I am referencing Dr. Caroline Leaf, Switch On Your Brain, and also Dr. Daniel Amen are the two people that I studied mostly this past year. Here's the thing. God created us perfectly. He gave us power of love and of sound mind. I'm either listening to God or Googling gossip. There's so much noise in our world and noise in our lives and in our homes that we have to be intentional to turn it off and to turn the notifications off and to turn the background off and the distractions off. And, you know, one of the things I've always admired about Cliff and Leah Lachlan is their no TV policy. Think about the noise that eliminates. I grew up in a home where my parents said no TV. I did not have a TV. We lived 3 miles out in the country from the closest little bitty grocery store. And thank God they had enough wisdom to know that reading and writing and critical thinking and conversation would be an important part of our growing up. Noise is a choice, and you can say, yeah, but at the end of the day, it's a choice. I've created some new rules for myself, and I'm going to invite you to embrace the ones that apply to you. I embrace silence or intentional music, but never, ever, never is the TV on first thing in the morning, ever. Never is someone else's news or voice or message the backdrop in my home, whether it's TV news or Voxer news or email news or Facebook news. Never. It's either music or it's quiet. As I was typing these notes, literally, I could hear the fireplace over any other noise. I could smell the candle in my home, and I could smell the hot tea I was drinking. I'm kind to my senses so that I can concentrate. And for those of you going, yeah, but you don't have little kids anymore, I'm talking that I got up at 5 a.m. to create the quiet. Daily, I keep it quiet until after my quiet time and breakfast. If I'm looking for a particular piece of news, I might turn it on at the end of breakfast, but most days not. When I start breakfast, I turn on music before I go back upstairs to put on my clothes for my workout. Romans 12:2, renew your mind. What else do you think it means? How does this play out? The science of thought is highly studied. Dr. Caroline Leaf is a neuroscientist who also happens to be a born-again believer. She fascinates me. Her clinical practice combined with research and authority when she says that science is just catching up with the Bible, it makes me excited. She says that getting your thoughts disciplined and under control is one of the first steps to freeing yourself of the burdens of this world and beginning to enjoy life despite the burdens of this world. The benefits of catching any negative thought cannot be emphasized enough. Dr. Leaf says that when you make a conscious decision to focus and direct your attention correctly, I'm still talking about goal setting and I'm getting ready to move into affirmation, so stick with me, that when you make a conscious decision to direct your attention correctly, you change the physical matter in your brain and body in a healthy way. She writes about interesting research relating to a type of protein called a prion protein and says it operates a little bit like Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. And in her book, Switch On Your Brain, she writes, when a prion protein folds over itself, it plays a crucial role in neurodegenerative diseases that lead to dreadful syndromes such as mad cow disease. But scientists have now found that the prion protein abounds in synapses. The contact point where signals are passed from one nerve to the next. Oh, y'all, hang in here with me. This is so important. Prions help create long-term sustaining memories. They're also important in neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity means that no matter what you thought yesterday, you can change your brain. You can change your mind. You can change your thought. Whatever you thought yesterday, you can rewire it and think differently today. And finally, they're involved in neurogenesis, these prion proteins in your beautiful brain. The point here is that this protein does amazing things in the brain in response to good signals, and it goes crazy to negative signals. Have you ever thought this thought? I have. I'm getting ready to tell you. Have you ever thought this thought? I think I'm losing my mind. Have you ever thought that thought? I have. A chaotic mind filled with uncaptured, rogue, negative thoughts of anxiety, worry, and any manner of fear-related emotions, it sends out the wrong signals in your brain. So there are some basic facts about our brain. We have all kinds of coordinated networks in our minds, and they form a constant intrinsic chatter in the non-conscious part of our mind. When these networks work correctly, we can increase our intelligence and our health. I'm going to talk to you about how to make these thought networks operate correctly in your mind. Are you ready? When we intentionally switch back and forth flexibly with creative thinking, we can capture our thoughts and control them. When we dig into a negative thought and we dig into it 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 and we beat ourselves up and we tell ourselves a story and a limiting belief becomes our pattern, we can think we're going crazy. But what God says is, I created you fearfully and wonderfully made. And science is now proving that what God said to us about our brain is true. We can override the negativity. When we direct our rest by introspection and self-reflection and prayer, when we catch our thoughts, when we memorize scripture, when we develop our mind intellectually, we improve our brain function as well as our body and mind and spiritual health. Toxic thinking produces miswiring in your brain, which causes maladaptive, depressive ruminations and decreases our ability to solve problems. Have you ever thought, I've just got too much going on in my brain, I can't even think straight? It makes us feel foggy. It makes us feel confused. It makes us negative. It makes us feel depressed. Your mind can powerfully and unexpectedly change your brain in positive ways when you intentionally direct your attention. I'm getting to affirmations. when you intentionally direct your attention. The non-conscious mind is where 99% of our mind activity is. It's the root level that stores the thought with the emotions and perceptions, and it impacts the conscious mind and what we do and what we say. If you've ever had an emotion come over you quickly, have you ever had something come over you like just jump into your mind and you thought, where'd that come from? There's a biological explanation for it. Everything is first a thought. You, however, get to choose how long that thought takes residence because your brain is designed to respond to your mind. Your brain is designed to respond to your mind. So if a thought comes into your mind, you capture it, you rethink it. Let me ask you this. Have you ever woken up from a dream at night and it's a scary dream? You're like, oh, where'd that come from? Whew, I do not want to dream that dream. And you think, okay, I'm going to dream something specifically different. I'm going to dream about, I remember once when Jerry, my late husband, let Thomas watch Jaws on a Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock. And I was like, okay, well, when he wakes up and you're going to be the one to go upstairs and talk to him. Sure enough, you know, 3:34 in the morning, Mom, I'm like, I think I hear your name. And so after about the third trip down, I went up, I'm like, ah, I went upstairs. I'm like, Thomas, what is it? He goes, there's a shark under my bed. I'm like, that is impossible. There cannot be a shark under your bed. Where do we live? Kentucky. Where do sharks live? In the ocean. Where's the ocean? Atlantic Pacific. There's not a shark under your bed. Ah, there's a shark under my bed. I'm like, you're going to have to think a different thought. What do you want to think about? Christmas. What about Christmas? Tell me about what you love most about Christmas. I love waking up and knowing. So we went through the whole thing. If a six-year-old can change his thoughts from a shark to Christmas, you, my friend, can change your thoughts from failure, unforgiveness, resentment, regret. And you can turn it into hope and promise and success and purpose and intentional influencing. Internal activity in your mind, it's where everything begins. Proverbs 23:7 says, for as a woman or man thinks in his or her heart, so is she. Thinking and your heart are lined up. Thinking is a blessing, not a curse to be taken lightly. A thought that just pops into your head, well, it's your responsibility to filter it. Only when that thought is repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated and repeated does it take ownership. And many of you have seen this little example that other people have done many, many times, because only when that thought is repeated does it take ownership and does it bring blessing or cursing. You've seen this before, creasing the piece of paper. I think a thought, I think a thought, I think it, I think it. I own the thought. Thought owns me. I think it. It's the truth. I thought it so many times. I actually believe it. I take action on it. It's the thought that I believe. Whether it's true or not doesn't matter because I believe it and I've thought it over and over and over and over again. I'm never going to make this happen. I'm never going to hit that goal. I'm never da 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 da. Okay, well, it's a thought. Woo! I'm going to change my thought. Oh, not quite so fast. I'm going to change my thought. Oh, not quite so fast. You've got to really work hard to create the new crease in the piece of paper. And that's what we're going to do with your thoughts. Choose life. Choose life. I bring before you blessing and cursing. Choose life. It's the epitome of God giving us the free will to choose. It's Him giving it. It's the epitome. We're not victims to our minds, regardless of how rampant they become. Think on these things. The most dominant thoughts will become what we take action on. Because when I put action behind my thoughts, guess what? That crease gets deeper. When I put activity behind my thoughts, that crease gets deeper. This works in the positive and negative direction. The belief is that if we cannot, we have not, we will not, then it dominates what we do not. Okay, affirmation process. Woo, I'm so excited. Okay. The affirmations to support my goals. The affirmations and habits are tied in close together. So in your design book, you're going to see there's space for you to write out your affirmations. The visual and affirmation process is critical. You've got to have a visual, an idea of what you want to be, of what you want to take place. I encourage you to put a poster board or a visual board up and a new one. Something that reminds you of winning and success, not failure and past. My affirmation journey goes like this. When I first became a part, when I opened my doors to Mary Kay and I made the decision to move up in the business, one of the things that was predominant then was creating affirmations. I had never heard of affirmations. I thought they sounded silly. You know, I'm a booking machine. No, I'm not. I easily attract people to this business. No, I don't. I make $10,000 a month at that time. Like, No, I don't. I thought it was silly. I didn't understand the whole thing about affirmations. And then it was not only learn how to make affirmations about the direction that you want to go, but go to Radio Shack and buy a pillow sleeper and plug it into your cassette player. And while you're sleeping at night, put the thing in your ear and let your affirmation tape that you not only have on cards, record your voice, and then let it roll all night long and let those affirmations run through while your subconscious mind is rested and let that happen. Let me tell you something. I thought that was ridiculous, but you know what? I did it anyway. I did it anyway, not because I knew about Dr. Caroline Leaf, and not because I thought that I could change my IQ, and not because I understood that I was fearfully and wonderfully made, and not because I knew that my mind controlled the matter of my brain, and not because I really thought that anything different would happen. I did it because of the authority of the people who were over me told me that it made a difference. Do you know how wise Mary Kay Ash, the woman, was? How ahead of her time in every category of conversation? That people who were doing those things then, and I jumped on board. And you know what? I have affirmation cassette tapes. I found them cleaning out a closet. They're hilarious to listen to. But guess what? I couldn't find an affirmation that had not already happened. I could not find an affirmation of a goal I hadn't already accomplished because they were a long time ago. Now, here's the good news. You don't need a pillow sleeper because we have smartphones, and your smartphone has a voice recorder, and I'm going to talk to you about how to make it happen. Of course, you can let them go all night long if you want to. But you have to get affirmations for your design book. And I've had them throughout many design books, but guess what? I dropped the habit of affirming them and reading them. I dropped the habit of affirmations. And it's only something that very recently I've added back in. I've recorded my affirmations on my smartphone. I have them printed in my design book. I have them printed in big font and laminated in my shower. And I already see a difference. An affirmation is a statement that affirms the direction you want to go. It's a retraining of your brain. You capture a thought, you retrain the brain, and you think on these things. When you speak and focus, what you speak on and what you focus on is what you think about. The Bible tells us to capture our thoughts and renew our thoughts. The only way you can do that is take charge of what's roaming through your head. Stop the madness, grab the thought, recreate an intentional one. It's bringing into your present what has already been completed. You just have to walk towards it. I would create an affirmation for every major goal category. You may want to, I have probably maybe three affirmations for each different goal. Affirmations need to be written with your brain processes. First person, I, present tense, am, positive behavior and result all tied in. But here's the other thing. Affirmations must include not only what you want, but what you're committed to doing and who you're committed to becoming to accomplish them. If you only wish you could take that promotion, but you have no measurable goal and no new activity and no new rearranging of your priorities and time, no new habits to support it, well, have fun playing. Have fun playing. It all has to tie in together. You want to change a thought? It works. You can change your thought. What do you need to change? What are some of your limiting beliefs? Work with me here. You know what? I'm never gonna finish the sentence. You know what? I always finish the sentence. You know what? I just can't finish the sentence. I just can't use a design book. Okay. And I'm not trying to sell you a design book. I'm here giving you for free, you and me for free, the process. It's not, the magic isn't in the book. The magic is in what you do with it. The process is truly a godsend. It was something God gave to me years ago that I have been faithful working with. However, I've had 90 days where I just wrote in the book and didn't really work the process. Because negative or limiting thoughts will come in. What if, let me tell you, your brain is so much more than those limiting thoughts, and so are you. You're fearfully and wonderfully made in God's image, so let's live like it. What if we lived the way God created us? What if we lived fearfully and wonderfully made? What if we lived in the gratitude of what we do have and not in the missing of what we don't have? What if we lived facing forward to what has promised us in the future? What if we captured all the negative thoughts and replaced them with renewed thoughts? What would our testimony be to other people looking on in our lives? Would we have to constantly tell them about our faith, or would they just look at us and say, I want what you have? I think that's the way it works. Affirmations are a result that you're committed to creating. It includes what you want along with the action to get it. Okay, some examples that I have edited from Hal Elrod's Morning Miracle book. Here's one. I'm committed to doubling my income the next 12 months from blank to blank so that I can provide financial security to my family, or so that I can start a savings and investment plan, or so that I can walk away from my day job and be a full-time entrepreneur. That's a good affirmation you might want to apply. I'm committed to doubling, tripling, quadrupling my income the next 12 months from blank to blank so that. So an affirmation is, I am committed to the specific of blank to blank, specific amount, and then why? So that you can financial security for your family, start an investment plan, walk away from your job. That's an example of an affirmation. Here's another one. You have to add the actionable piece of it. To ensure that I double my sales and profit, I'm committing to doubling my daily prospecting from 20 to 40. 20 people to 40 people, 5 days a week. Between 8 and 9 a.m., no matter what. So you've got the goal, the action, the specific, the what, and the when. Okay? Here's another example. To ensure that I lose 20 pounds, I'm committed to going to the gym 5 days a week and teaming up with the boot camp group between 6 and 7 a.m. Okay? So your affirmation is including a 20-pound weight loss. And then what are you doing with that? Because I'm committed to going to the gym 5 days a week to do what? Stand around and look? No, it's a result. It's the act. It's the result that you're committed to creating. I'm going to be working out with a boot camp. Okay, so I'll do that when? Between 6 and 7 a.m. That is a good affirmation. Okay? Affirmations create a picture of who you need to become, what you need to do, so that you can have the results. It's not just, I earn three times more this year than next. Mm-mm. It's gotta be comprehensive. This strategy works because when you connect the person that you wanna become on the way of achieving your goals, there's agreement in your brain, and this will work. It's who you are and who you become that brings about the results more than anything else. Who you are and who you become. Okay, I'm gonna give you one of my real ones, ready? Self-disclosure. I'm completely health and fit, physically active, 5+ workouts a week. I'm sugar-free and enjoy whole, healthy foods as a preference. I weigh 120 pounds with 13% body fat. I feel energetic, fit, sexy, and skinny when I maintain 120. That's mine. Okay. What's yours? Create an affirmation for each of the goal categories. Don't overdo it. Don't underdo it. Create an affirmation for each of the categories. Okay, it says it's froze. Okay, there we go. I see somebody. Okay. Using your current technology on your smartphone, on the background of my affirmations when I read them, in the background I have playing Great Is Thy Faithfulness. Maybe you want to use classical music. Maybe you want to use music that doesn't have any words to it if it's distracting to you. But in the back of mine starts out and it goes, Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. And then it starts and my first one starts. And so then I lower the volume and elevate it. Okay, get this. They're typed, they're laminated, and they're also in my shower so that when I'm in my shower, I also read them out loud again with passion daily. Then I also made an evening one. This is new. I made an evening affirmation tape so that my brain will wind back down and I will prepare my brain for sleep. If you haven't shared this yet, go ahead and share it, because I think it's pretty radical. I think it's pretty exciting. It's tied into biblical truth. It's tied into the way that God made our brains to work. And he tells us to capture our thoughts and to renew them. And when we capture them and renew them his way, not new age, name it, claim it, I want this, I want, no. We started out with, I will guide you along the pathway for your life. We started out with, and I challenged you to answer the questions, sit down, pray, ask God to show you, then answer the questions. We're way past name it, claim it. Okay, so here's the start of my nighttime tape that I put, the recording on my smartphone, played in my notes, played. Here's the way it starts. I'm not going to give you the whole thing, but here's the way it starts. I've completed all the daily tasks necessary to prepare myself for tomorrow, including setting out everything for my ideal morning. Design book set, journal, Bible, coffee, workout clothes. My alarm is set at 5:45 and I wake easily before it goes off. I have clarity as to what I will do when I wake. I'm anticipating the morning with positive expectations and excitement because I'm well aware of the benefits that I'll receive by choosing to wake up and live the design of my life. Hearing a fresh word from God, expanding the faith and clarity of my vision. It's longer, but it's got classical slow music behind it. It's about 5 minutes long. I usually fall asleep before it finishes, and it's already in nighttime mode, so I don't have to change anything to my clock. My room is already completely dark, so I'm already ready for my sleep. Getting to bed on time has been a discipline that I've had to choose to give into as part of the sacrifice. But reminding yourself of what you'll do to stay on track will push you through those tough spots. So the affirmations are in my design book, in my shower, on a recording. I have specific times to read them in the shower, to listen to my affirmation recording in the morning, at the end of my quiet time while it's still quiet, it's still dark outside, and then reflect in my design book at the end of the week when I go back and look at my goals, go back and look at those affirmations at the same time throughout the beginning of each week. What do you think? What do you think? Okay, I'm excited. Oh my goodness. Will somebody post for me what time it is? Because I think I'm like way behind. Okay, habits. We've all heard this. First you create your habits and then your habits create you. We have all heard that. But it's true. We create our habits and then our habits create us. And so on the right side of your design book, Habits to Create, it says, by breaking the habit of blank, because we always talk about, I'm going to break a habit. I'm going to break a habit. I'm going to break the habit of sleeping in. Well, you can't do that until you create the habit of waking up early. I want to break the habit of eating sugar. Well, you can't do that until you create the habit of eating a healthier option. And so I really want to urge you to think through what habits we're talking about here. Okay? So on the right side of the board, first you choose your habits and then your habits choose you. Last year I was in an airport. It'd been a long travel day and I'd eaten clean on the trip, the entire trip. And I went to a restaurant and the smell of cookies was absolutely overwhelming. And I was just getting ready to order that cookie. I mean, I was tasting how good it was going to be with my coffee. And just as I was getting to the time where it was my turn to order, I noticed this gal, two people in front of me, and she had on Lululemon shorts and cowboy boots. And somehow she was walking in my ideal body. I do not know how it happened, but she was wearing my body. And so I all of a sudden I tuned into what she was ordering and I followed suit. I didn't eat the cookie. I didn't order the cookie. I followed suit. There's little random to our why and our what. Our why and our what make sense. Our why and our what make sense because our choices and our habits make sense. See, here's the reality. I first think a thought. I either capture it, renew it, own it, or let it go. My thought repeated will cause me to take action. I will take that action. When I do that same action or inaction, action can be inaction. I have a thought, I do the inaction. That kind of turns into belief, that turns into result, that turns into character. To change a thought takes great focus and attention. I would suggest no more than three, one or two is a stretch. So, what habit do you want to change? Sleep, fitness, size, working out, finances, career title. Habits are nothing more than patterns. The pattern that you've created gives you the outcome that you're after. The pattern that you've created gives you the outcome that you're after. So, your pattern. When you wake up in the morning, what's your pattern? What do you do? And then what do you do? I'll bet most of you don't have a very consistent pattern, or if you do, it's not intentional. It feels good. It's what you feel like doing. However, those of you who are super disciplined and are in a great mode right now, you get up and what's your pattern? I've said forever that you could follow me around the first 2 hours of every day and the last hour of every night, and it would look pretty much the same. So what is your pattern? When I was a little girl, my mother is a home economics teacher, and she and my older sister loved to sew. And so we spent a lot of time in fabric stores, and we would always go, and they would pick out fabrics, and they could stay forever in fabric stores, and looking at buttons and fabrics, and I'd be like, I just want a new shift. I just want a new dress. I know what I want it to look like, and I would go get the pattern. I would say, I want this. So my mother would get the pattern, pick out the fabric, we'd come home and spread it all out of the basement floor and then put the patterns down and then pin it and then start cutting around the pattern and sew and trim and stand, and I would stand, she would fit. And I would be like, I don't know how the world that pattern is going to become that great outfit with the fur trim on it. I had an idea, and sure enough, she gave me the outfit. This happened over and over and over and over and over in my lifetime. The pattern created the product. The pattern had a size. The pattern had a designated ending point. And that pattern creates the product. Your patterns are giving you your product. What's your pattern? Your patterns are giving you your product. Habits draw on our self-discipline. People who are not self-disciplined are slaves to their feelings. This squashes joy, and it causes all sorts of trouble throughout our lives. If you are operating on your feelings and your emotions, if a person feels like exercising, and who is that? If you feel like exercising, then you do. Okay, good luck, because, you know, I don't ever feel like exercising until I'm 10 minutes into my warm-up. If you feel like exercising, you do it. If you don't, you won't. If a person feels like budgeting and planning, she will. And if she doesn't, she won't. If a person feels like having an important conversation with her own child, she will. If she doesn't, she won't. If a person feels like having a conversation with her employer or director or about transparent accountability, she will. And if she doesn't, she won't. If it's going to be convenient, she will. If it's not, maybe risk some awkwardness, she won't. Whatever a person is feeling at the moment becomes their guiding force, and typically they're very defensive about the freedom they have to do what they want. And guess what? You're right. You are free to think about what you want and do what you want and say what you want, but you're also, at the end of your choice, you're going to get the result or consequence of your choice, and that will also be on no one but you. There's a big difference between what we can't do and what we won't do in our circumstances. Can't suggests a limitation. Won't is about our emotional willingness. People toss their bad habits in the can't pile versus the won't pile. Self-discipline for me occurs when my intention defeats my emotion. Self-discipline occurs for me when my vision trumps my mood. Self-discipline works for me when my action wins over procrastination. So the question to ask maybe is, how might last year have been different for you every time you could have taken a positive action if you'd made that choice instead of denial, procrastination, or delay? How might 2016 have been different? Stop. Point forward. From this point moving forward, how will your choices advance, accelerate, give you the intentional outcome you want? Self-discipline helps to keep our impulsivity and desire for instant gratification in check. The habit of choosing something lesser today for something greater tomorrow. Our feelings can't become the catalyst for our decisions. Consider road rage. Consider adultery. If our thoughts aren't first trained and our habits restrained and our habits solid, then our feelings run wild. And if that's the case, outcomes can become deadly. Does a person carefully consider doing something wrong? Do they stop and pause and think of all the possibilities, pray and evaluate the circumstance and think about all the possible outcomes, the reward, the consequence, and then proceed doing something outrageous like road rage or adultery with a clear conscience? No. But you are going to pause when your impulse and your emotions are telling you to wait or delay or procrastinate, or you don't have to, or you don't feel like it, or a limiting belief from behind pops in and the crease of piece of paper gets old and you're debating. Stop. Capture. Affirm. Renew. Look at the goal. Pause for 30 seconds and then make your choice. It's the only way you're going to take new into the new year. Whether it's chips and cookies, a spending spree, staying up late, putting off chores, excessive social media and technology, these actions or inactions are sustained with inappropriate thoughts to accompany them. You're drunk with emotion. Stop. Capture. Renew. Affirm. Take a different action. Change the pattern. change the pattern. You must act your way into a feeling, not feel your way into an action. When I first came into Mary Kay, one of the conversations was about burning desire. You got to have burning desire. You got to have a burning desire. I'm like, how do you get a burning desire? I wanted a burning desire to just like fall out of the sky. Bring me some burning desire. I didn't know how to get it. I couldn't find the burning desire. Here's the reality. You can better behave your way into higher emotions by thinking and acting in a way that is consistent with your future emotional goal. How will you feel? How would you act if you attained that goal? Endorphins that come from behavior over feelings is huge. Marking off intentional checklists, things that you've checked, that you say you want to do, they light up the same centers in the brain as pleasure drugs for drug addicts. Just the list and the check. Just the daily list, writing it down and using color and checking it off. The same endorphins start firing as they do for the drug addict. Listen, gang, true Christianity reveals that our lives are a beautiful dance between God's sovereignty and man's responsibility. Free will is the gift that proves that we're not robots with an already determined pathway. It's a choice. God's ever-present and omniscient in our lives. It's like a loving parent to adult children. We get to choose. He waits for our attention as we seek his best advice and counsel. If you believe God has a plan for your life that's got to translate into incredible enthusiasm and joy as well as action, what is he calling you to do today? I don't want you to be inspired. What's he calling you to do today? Do that. Consider meeting your goal, the celebration. Imagine how you'll feel, but don't just stay at the party. Go out there to grab the goal. Go out there to create the affirmation. But then what habits need to change in your life? What changes as a result of this win? And how will you carry yourself through that habit? Assume the mood. Tommy Newberry in the 4-8 principle says, acting your way into feelings is simply the discipline that aligns your behavior with your spoken values. Acting your way into feelings is the simplicity of the discipline that aligns your behavior with what you say you want. You know, we face defining moments all day long, every day, every hour, every 5 minutes. It takes mental discipline to override the old pattern. Even though they may be more comfortable, your negative emotions are rooted in untruth. They are lies. And they make you feel insecure and not qualified for success. Listen, the enemy is out looming. He's luring. He's looking. He's trying to take you down. He's looking to steal, to kill, and to destroy your life. However, God came to give you life to the full, abundant, audacious, overflowing life. And so therefore, you get to decide your goals. You get to affirm the way it's going to be by capturing your thoughts and renewing your mind. And then you get to change your habits because you are not a robot. You're not stuck in the pattern of yesterday because you get to choose differently today. If you don't master overriding your feelings, you're doomed to only ever having positive emotions that arise from the rare circumstances when everything just happens to spontaneously go well. Any new habit, thought, or decision feels awkward until it's repeated over and over and over, and then it feels natural. Only when you have a compelling reason will you take action. How do you elevate focus and clarity of your goal so that your mission will surpass your mood, even in private? What do I really want? What do I really want? Do I really want to have another year like 2016, 2015, 2014? What do I really want? What do I want now? What do I want most? If good enough works for you, you may have to push to discover your best. Best is the opposite of good. Good enough might have been your 2016. I earned enough. I had enough excitement. I got enough. What do I want? What do I want right now? Because what do I really want usually differs from what I want right now. What I want right now, I want to eat whatever. I want to watch a show. I want to whatever it is. What do I want most? Oh, what I want most is what I want in 2017. What I want most is the 10 things that I want to happen this year. What I want most is what would make 2017 the best year ever. What do I want now? I want to go to bed. I want to eat what I want. I want to watch TV. What do I want most? What I want most is, what would make 2017 the best year ever? What are the top 10 things that I want this year? Are you following me? You got to learn how to ask yourself these questions. I behave my way into a new feeling. I have to become my own best coach. Consider the alternatives. Another year of the same. The 4-8 principle comes from Philippians, and it is, think about these things. Whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is admirable, whatever is excellent, whatever is praiseworthy. Think about these things. The best way to create a new habit is to decide your default thoughts. My default thought is gratitude. It may take me a minute to get there after I feel sorry for myself for a minute, but where I land is gratitude. In order to repeat this, I've got to create a new pattern for it. I have for years developed the habit of framing my day, the first 2 hours and the last hour. Follow me around for a week and you'll see a strong pattern in the first 2 hours and the last hour. Successful people. People who define themselves as successful, financially independent, achieving goals, serving, moving forward, advancing in their lives, getting promotions, moving forward, creating, stepping into God's greatness, benefiting others. They have some common morning and evening habits. And I'm going to give you four things. So write these down, those of you who are with me. Number one, consistent wake and sleep times. Knowing your best hours of sleep. For me, I need to be asleep by 9:30, 10 o'clock latest, preferably 9. And sometimes I'll go to bed earlier, especially when the sun is like it is. An early wake time, early to bed, early to rise makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise. My grandmother used to say that. But consistent wake times, your wake times don't have to be my wake times, but you've got to have consistent wake times. The minimum number of hours of sleep that is considered healthy for the brain, for the body, and for longevity is 7. That's not enough for me, but 7 is the minimum. According to scientific research, that's number one, consistent wake and sleep times. That may be the hardest habit you have to do because you got to rearrange your house, rearrange the noise to make it happen. My mother used to go to bed at 9 o'clock. Didn't matter what the rest of us did. When we were teenagers and adults, it was like, you know what? She finally said, she said to herself, I need 9 hours sleep. I'm going to bed at 9 o'clock. And she did. My mother's 84. She does yoga. You should have seen the spread she cooked for us yesterday. It was just like out of a Southern Living magazine. Still. In the heat of grief, my dad's been gone 9 months, our first Christmas without him. She's remarkable. She practiced healthy self-care early in her life. Number two, have structure to your morning. When you wake up and you know what is next, it keeps you from having to negotiate what to do first. If I woke up and I didn't know what I was going to do next, I'd have to negotiate every day based on how I feel. Oh my gosh, I cannot imagine. That's exhausting. Who would want to do that? When you wake up, know what comes next. For me, it is, the coffee has already been preset. I smell it. I turn off the alarm. The coffee is down. I pour the coffee. I turn on the fireplace. I turn on the Christmas lights. I go to my quiet time location, my war room place. I have my Bible open, my prayers for my people, all my people's listings, names, the people that I pray for, friends, work associates, my directors, my friends, and truly get into the word of praying for them, get into God's word, learning, devotional, quiet time, reading my affirmations and listening to my affirmations. That's the front part of my day. Then at 7:30, I let the dog out. I eat breakfast. I put my workout clothes on. Because my workout clothes, I laid them out the night before and I put them on my heated bathroom floor. Don't hate me. You can put yours by a heater. You know, the reality is most people don't work out because they don't know what to wear when they wake up. But that comes in the evening. So then I go to my workout and then I come back from my workout 9:45-ish, 10. I have a scheduled day. I have a lot of alarms set throughout the day and the week on my smartphone to keep me on track. Nighttime, I let the dog out. I crate the dog. I set the coffee. I put my supplements out. I turn the fire off. I turn the lights off. I set the alarm. I put my workout clothes out. I wash my face. I put lotion on my feet. I read. I do my evening affirmation. My lights go out. Boom. Bam. Here's the microphone. Bam. Yours don't have to be mine, but what are yours? Yours don't have to be mine, but what are yours? Because if you don't have them, you wake up and you have to decide every single day what to do first. You have to negotiate every day. I do not have to negotiate every day. I've already decided I'm going to work out today. My coffee, my quiet time, I don't have to decide if I feel like it, if the sun's coming up, if it's raining, if somebody else is making noise in my house. I don't have to decide. I've already decided. Frame your day with those things. That's how you create a habit. When I create that habit and I know I can count on myself, I can then create other habits. Here's the deal. Number of hours in a day. This is all you've got. This is what you've got. Okay. Can you see it? 5 a.m. to 10 p.m. Half hour at a time. If I wake up at 5 and I'm downstairs by 5:30 or 6 and I have my coffee and I do my quiet time, by 7:30 I let the dog out. 8 o'clock I'm getting dressed. 8:45 I'm at the gym. By 10 o'clock I'm home. Bam, I've got all this time in here that I get to work. Schedule my day. If it doesn't fit here, it doesn't fit. And if you're not fitting it in the little yellow sticky pad that belongs in that, if you're not filling out a yellow sticky pad every day for the day of your life, then the reality is you're just winging it. You're deciding in the minute what you feel like doing. And you're never going to be able to accelerate your success based on your feelings and your emotions. So these hours in the day, they tie back into my goals, my affirmations, and my appointments come in here somewhere. People purchase date books to make appointments. I designed a planner for you to gain clarity, for you to have a process to set goals, to tweak and adjust those goals so that I could adjust my habits and become a person who can accomplish what I want by holding appointments. That's a big difference. When you purchase a date book, you purchase it on how you're going to see your appointments. I designed the planner so that I could gain clarity on what I want, so that I could set goals, tweak and adjust my habits, so that I can become a person who can accomplish what I want by holding appointments. For those of you who have asked, you can go to PamelaShaw.pink. You can sign up on my mailing list. I'll send you more information, other training, but meet me there. For those of you who just joined, I'm Pamela Shaw. I hope you share. I'm going to wrap it up right now. If I want to make 20 calls tomorrow, it had better have a time slot. 3 o'clock, 20 calls. If I just have make 20 calls tomorrow on my list, but not on a time slot, I will be transferring make 20 calls for the next 90 days. What I do has to have a time slot. If it's only on my list, it won't happen. I will do everything to keep from taking that off my list. I'll scroll through social media. I'll react to incoming information and emails. I will like other people's posts. I will make a post or two. I'll repost a thing or two. I'll record a thing or two. I'll do something productive. I'll fold a load of laundry. I'll rearrange a pile. I'll send out or forward a thing or two. I'll call it a day. If, on the other hand, my goals are supported by my affirmations, and my habits are supporting the activity of my day, and my day, my to-do has a timed appointment on my yellow sticky pad, this part of my scheduling takes a much different focus. So I schedule my to-do. This is a day. This is a daily page. You can see this in your design book. And I'm not going to go through this right now because I pretty much just talked through the whole piece of it. And I'll break that up more often because I think I've talked about that probably the most of any other page. Here's what I want you to do in closing. There are 168 hours in a week. I'm going to give you my average week. Okay? My average week, 56 hours sleep, 15 hours for meals. And I took some time to think about this a long time ago, and I've revamped it and relook at it. This is not just like regurgitate. This is kind of what I really do. 56 hours sleep, about 15 hours on meals, 13 hours between quiet time and church, 12 hours between exercise and travel time. And y'all are going, whoa! Yeah, because in order for me to be at my best, that's got to happen first. 6 hours family, 3 hours friends, 2 hours reading, 42 hours work, 8 hours shower and dress, 3 hours errands, personal appointments. That's 160 hours. I have 8 hours left. And I padded in all that. I have 8 hours left. What are you going to do with your 8 hours? I'll bet some of you have up to 25 or 30. Some of you have more. But when you figure out where your hours are going, what are you going to do with your prime time hours? When you look at your hours against your day and the hours in that day, then you ask yourself one leveraged question. What is the one thing I can do towards the accomplishment of that goal that would make the biggest difference in my victory? What is the one thing I can do in the goal of my finances that would make the biggest difference? What is the one thing I can do in my business that would give me the biggest bang for my buck, that would make the biggest difference towards my goal of what is the one thing I can do towards my health today that will make the give me the biggest bang for my buck? What is the one thing that I can do in as much it would make everything else easier or even unnecessary? Every day, each goal has an answer to that question. What are your other questions? Remember them? Remember the other two questions? In addition to what is the one thing, there are only two other questions I want you to ask every single day. What is a winning day for me today? What will winning look like? And two is what I'm about to do, taking me closer to my goal. The reality is this, time invested in one area is time away from another. Time invested in one area is time away from another. If you think you don't have time, I say you're too distracted. If you think you don't have time, I think you haven't fully defined what the joy of your heart is, what the dream big is, what the vision is, what would make you feel like 2017 is the most amazing year ever if it happened, what 10 things you want to happen this year. I think you haven't done your homework if you think that sounds like too big of a price. And now, what is the one thing? Then you organize your six most important things to do. I use color. I use colored pens. I make it colorful and I make it fun. And to me, that's the biggest piece of keeping my attention is using color. In the Mary Kay business, what you've got to understand is that most promotions and opportunities, they're not random. There is a pattern. They have a pattern. What is it in your business or your world? In the Mary Kay business, if you want to earn the use of a career car with the overriding vision of moving up, not just for the checklist, you know, but it's like 3 + 3 + 500 a week. Three solid parties, three quality face interviews where you're coaching a person to the desires of her heart and at least 500 in new sales. That's in the Mary Kay business. What is it in yours? Successful people have patterns and they have not held out their secrets of success for you. You know what they are. You either ignore them or you do them. You don't have growth in your organization right now. Who are you waiting on to grow it? I don't understand this part. If there's no growth, why wouldn't you go out and grow it? Broken down into coached and pre-profiled parties, components, people to call. Do I have people to call? Do I know what to say? Do I know how to confirm a solid party? Do I know what the hostess wants? Her guest list, did I retrieve it ahead of time so that I could call each guest? Do I have inventory on shelf to prepare a roll-up for each guest? Do I have a party procedure that's engaging and moves and excites people and informs people? Do I have a close that offers clear options? Do I have a one-on-one close so that I can let her know how special she is and appreciate and find out what her needs are, meeting those needs, booking her for color? Do I have the full circle possibility, opportunity? Do I know how to share that information? In our business, a director in a unit club, it's about 100 star consultants that, and a unit of 250 would make the million in our business. Broken down into a plan for growth, the director plus the team, how many people the director's in front of, there's a pattern for the number of people you need to be in front of. You're going to ignore that and look back and go with limiting beliefs and old school, or you're going to face forward and say, I take responsibility for this fulfillment of this goal, and I'm going to get the number straight, and I'm going to take time to process, and those are going to become my new habits, and I'm going to include them in my day, and I'm going to design them in the course of the day in the 168 hours I have a week. How many people the director's in front of and effectively coaching her people to success, taking personal responsibility for the growth. This process can translate into any business, job, hobby, career, workout, finances. Get your head out of the sand and stop pretending not to know. You know, you're fearfully and wonderfully made. Your brain can override your mind. Your brain can override your thoughts. You truly can tell it what to do. Stop being mad at somebody else for what you're not doing. Stop regretting what you haven't done. Stop thinking that there's not enough time. You can win. Take the first step in faith. You don't have to see the top stair of the Statue of Liberty to walk to the top. You just have to take one step and keep walking up. Why? Because steps accumulate. At the end of the week, you reprocess it all over again. Average leaders have a quote. Good leaders have a plan. Exceptional leaders have a system. This is a system that you can follow, that you can design to be your own, that you can customize for your priorities, for your goals, for your accomplishments. At the end of the week, complete the process, repeat the process. Complete the process, repeat the process. Some of you are leaders of large teams and organizations. Some of you are thinking, I'm not a leader. You surely are. You're leading your life. Until you lead yourself, Truly, nobody else is going to do it for you. If you're tired of that story, then change the story. She who cannot set herself on fire cannot warm another person. Don't let disappointment or obstacles or the unforeseen derail you. Anticipate obstacles. Nobody's going to come in and do it for you. People who let you down, they're going to let you down. People who bail on you, they're going to bail on you. People who don't do or don't say what you think they should say, me included, that's not the deal. That's not the win or the loss. So what now what? There is a song by Laura Story. I heard it shortly after Jerry died. So it's about 10 years in the producing. But I love her music and I love the story. And it goes like this. We pray for blessings. We pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need, yet love us way too much to give us lesser things. What if when friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, when we know the pain reminds this heart? Because what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if 1,000 sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments and the aching of this life is the revealing of a greater thirst this world can't satisfy? What if the trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, what if they're your mercies in disguise? Stop looking for easy. Just start doing the best version of you. Success, personal, spiritual, relationship growth, financial. The goal is not to make them easy. The goal is to design your life and do the work, the push through, so that your character is ready for promotion. It's who you become, not even what you do, that ultimately defines a readiness for more. When I have and give responsibility to what I have, I ready myself for more. Let us not become or reflect an entitled tendency of our current society. Nobody owes me anything. God has given me everything I need to dig in, to grit it out, and to go to work as I serve and bless others through whatever job you're currently in. So we'll be shipping design books on Wednesday the 28th. If you need one, go to PamelaShaw.pink. Get yours and start setting it up immediately. But don't wait. Do not wait for the book to start working it out. I pray that today's process of goal setting, long-term, short-term, mid-term, end of the month, end of the week, end of the day, that the affirmation process, that you will sit down and prayerfully, carefully think through your affirmations, record them, write them, laminate them, print them, put them in your design book, start recording them, consider an evening affirmation time as well. And your habits. What do you want to break the habit of by creating the habit of doing? You got to make a new habit to crowd out the old habit. When you get those habits in place and you just start trading out every day and you ask those three questions, they simply relate to this. What do I want now? What do I want most? Is what I'm about to do taking me closer to my goal? What is the one thing that I could do that would make the biggest difference? What is a winning day for me? Get in the habit of asking those questions and be that person. We're saying goodbye to 2016 and the previous season of our life. We're embracing 2017. From this point forward, no looking back, no beating up. From this point forward, what's it going to look like? So here we have the 26th through the 31st. We have a head start. We have a jump start. God bless you. Thank you for your patience and whatever happened the first 30 minutes of today. I don't even know. But I pray that something you heard today will give you a jump start and a kickstart into your 2017. I can't wait to hear about it. I hope you'll let me know. Please feel free to share the video. I'm going to go ahead and post it to my page now for those of you who came in late. Have a blessed day and a happy new year.